some interesting news from Axios, which says that the Joe Biden team, the transition team, thought that one of the ways that they could woo the left, AOC types in particular, was by picking a progressive woman of color named Neera Tanden. Ryan, I mean, I'm not on the left, and even I know that's incredibly stupid. And so tell me about what this portends, and let's throw that story up there on the screen. I mean, what does this portend for the administration going forward?
It's unclear whether this, you know, more strongly represents a lack of understanding of kind of online culture or the kind of progressive wing of the Democratic Party, or both at the same time. But it does reveal a rather glaring and alarming blind spot. That it's not that every single person within Biden's inner circle, you know, needs to be up on all of the different relationships between different factions within the party, but you would think that you'd have at least one person in the room who'd be able to say, wait, what was the theory there behind the Neera Tanden pick that AOC's crew is going to like that? Maybe Neera Tanden is a great pick, but that's not the reason that we're going to make this pick. Now, they are dead on that the AOC crew, as Axios called them, did not want Bruce Reed to be OMB head. And they're also correct that the folks like AOC would prefer Neera Tanden to Bruce Reed. They probably prefer anybody to Bruce Reed. But the idea that you were going to make them happy because it was an activist woman of color is just a kind of wildly disturbing flattening of everything that's going on, you know, from the center left on. And you know, the Biden team is proud of saying that they don't care what happens on Twitter, and you can, you know, beat your chest about that and be proud of that. It is an awful, terrible website. If you can also figure out a way to keep your finger on the pulse of what's going on in the country, you can't both proudly proclaim ignorance of what's going on Twitter, but then also, you know, be this disconnected from elements of it that do actually translate into real life.
Yeah, it's just kind of hilarious. But at the same time, Ryan, I mean, you had an interesting new piece. Let's put that up there on the screen, talking about just the general way that things are trending, comparing Biden's administration picks to Obama's and how it's revealing. As I understand, the general crux of it is that, you know, they're not great, but in almost every single way, they are different than from 2009. And I guess I would say, yeah, I mean, it's been, you know, 10 years. So I would hope so, right? I mean, for example, I don't think a Republican will ever appoint somebody like Paul Wolfowitz ever again, right? Like, who's somebody who's just an outward neocon going to war. That doesn't mean that on a policy level that they're not going to do things more aligned with Paul Wolfowitz today than they would with somebody who is against intervention. That's just kind of how I see it on the Democratic side. What do you think?
Yeah, I think this assessment should be seen, you know, more as what you're talking about, as a reflection of the way that the parties have shifted over the years, rather than as some type of a value judgment that Biden is some type of superior president to Barack Obama. But it also shows just how enthralled to Wall Street the Obama administration was in its early years, and not coincidentally that a lot of those people have gone back to Wall Street since then. You know, even at the OMB pick, comparing Neera Tanden to Peter Orszag, you know, Peter Orszag, who went to, you know, Citigroup and is at Lazard Financial now, is a budget hawk that can kind of give Bruce Reed a run for his money, and he spent his time at OMB, you know, hemming in the ambitions of the Obama administration. That's just one pick. If you go through the rest of them, you know, you compare Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel to Chief of Staff Ron Klain. Kind of no competition. Biden is doing better there. If you look at the Treasury Department, you've got Treasury Secretary Tim Geithner compared to Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen. Janet Yellen is not a fire-breathing Sanders supporter, but obviously an improvement over Tim Geithner. Brian Deese, a lot of people have objected to his appointment, particularly because of his time at BlackRock. That position was held in the Obama administration by Larry Summers. You know, so pick after pick, it might be depressing to kind of think about it, but there are improvements being made. Now, like you said, we're 12 years down the road. That's 12 years closer to the time that the global economy needs to be turned around to stave off climate mm-hmm. apocalypse. We've had 12 more years of yawning inequality, wage and wealth inequality widening further. And so the scale of the overlapping crises are much, much greater. So incremental improvement, while the country and the world are deteriorating at a rapider pace, isn't really going to cut it.
Yeah, and I think that that's a very good point. And look, this is why I try to be nuanced and honest here. When I say things like, you know, Jake Sherman, a lot of people on the right hate him because he was involved with the Iran deal. He also, in 2017, wrote a foreign policy piece saying, quote, neoliberalism is dead, and talking about how foreign policy can be used to achieve economic ends. I take that as a win, man. I take that as a win that, like, we actually did something and pushed enough of a critique that somebody who was so hardened in the neoliberal ways was like, hey, you know what? Trump's election meant something. And when we govern, we're going to have to govern differently. I also don't think anybody's going to be talking a big game about how a rising China is going to lift all boats, and that's good. Is that going to stop mm-hmm. them? This is the question, though, and this is why I don't want to be too optimistic. Is that going to stop them from going for TPP 2.0? That's the question that I really don't know. And I guess, I'm curious because you talk to these people more than I do. They seem so rigid in the idea that they have done absolutely nothing wrong, and especially that 2016 was not a referendum on them whatsoever.
Right, right. Now, TPP will be an interesting one. Biden was pressed on that in the second Democratic debate, and he said what he would do is he would go to some of his Central and South American Pacific Ring partners, and then he would approach the Asian countries that were involved in TPP and see, you know, what kind of deal could be cut, but it would not be like the old deal is the way he put it. And I actually asked the Biden transition about TPP recently, and they referred me back to his comments at that debate. The Deputy Treasury Secretary, Wally Adeyemo, was involved in TPP. My understanding is that his role was to do currency manipulation, currency reform. And the organized labor and the progressive world was actually pretty happy with where the TPP wound up when it came to currency, because that's a trade issue that people need to pay a lot of attention to. The bigger concerns were around workers' rights and around pharmaceutical and other patents, where the U.S. is trying to kind of drive these countries into the ground over drug prices and exploiting slave labor, forced labor, and on. But you're right. Well, do they feel like they did anything wrong in their approach to trade, do they think that Trump was just a demagogue on it and they can just get back to where they were? You know, if they actually go through with this harebrained scheme of putting Rahm Emanuel as U.S. trade representative, that would be a huge signal that they don't remotely see trade policies of the last several decades as having eroded not just the middle class, but their base of support.
Yeah, and it's funny. I mean, we were talking before about how hilarious it is. The first Biden interview goes to Tom Friedman, of course, over the New York Times. But look, here's the headline of Tom's piece. We're going to fight like hell by investing in America first. I mean, who said it? Joe Biden or Donald Trump? Like, and in a way, it's like, this is what I have to grapple with all the time. Is it a win that you're starting to get people to talk the way that they should be talking? I mean, or do you have to fight and make sure that they're following through on what that actually means? I mean, look, I praised Build Back Better here, $700 billion Buy American plan. I don't really care who proposes it. I support whoever is going to do something like that. And so that's the real question going forward. I'm very clear-eyed about who he's appointed there and more. But it's a real interesting way of thinking about how political movements change, how they're going to go forward. And the ball is still very much in the air. We really don't know. But we're going to have more Rising for everybody right after this.